Operators were increasingly aware of the importance of the appearance of their coaches, and Duple's styling stood out in a crowded marketplace with the introduction of a new aerodynamic style.
We then got into the streamline era, and around about 1935 you had some quite remarkable designs.
Luxury coach builder Harrington decided to produce coach bodies with a distinctive Harrington look.
The designs in the 1930s for coaches got quite bizarre, really. One of the most interesting ones was the Harrington, which had a dorsal fin at the back. And they always said that this was for ventilation. Because the floors used to rise at the back and the back of the bodywork came down, there wasn't really enough room for your head. So it also made a little bit more headroom at the back. The dorsal fins carried on right until the early 1950s. They were quite a trademark of Harrington.
One of the largest bus and coach operators was Ribble Motor Services, whose express services, holiday tours and excursions carried the Ribble name nationwide. Ribble was the biggest buyer of Leyland's LZ2 chassis, the Cheetah, with a six-cylinder, 4.7-litre petrol engine. In total, the company purchased 309 Cheetah buses and coaches. One of Leyland's big cats, this 31-seat Cheetah, was new to Ribble in June 1936.
The Cheetah dates from the mid-30s, I think 1936 to be precise. It was a bespoke design. It was quite a lightweight chassis with a coach-built body by Brush of Loughborough, and very well appointed, very Art Deco, which would reflect that period.
One of the first batch of 40 coaches for Ribble, the Cheetah cost £1,210 new.
The journeys of that period would by definition be much shorter. There weren't the motorways, obviously. There were A roads weren't sort of particularly good. So it would do shorter journeys from, I guess, Preston to the Lake District and places like that. It'd be out and back in a day, I would have thought.
After the war, the coach was fitted with a diesel engine and relegated to reserve coaching work. Entering preservation in 1976, Ribble Vehicle Preservation Trust purchased the Cheetah in 2009. Day tours were initially a 2 or 3 hour afternoon or evening trip to the seaside. But with more comfortable coaches, trips further afield became possible. Places such as Shakespeare's birthplace in Stratford-upon-Avon saw visitor numbers grow from 14,000 in 1904 to 200,000 by 1938 as the nation took to the road. The declaration of war in September 1939 had a positive effect on bus and coach operators initially. Pleasure trips ceased, but with petrol rationed for private cars, express service passenger numbers soared. Private hire coach services limped on, eking out rationed fuel, until coach operators were required to suspend services altogether at the end of 1942. Many coaches were commandeered, and manufacturers turned their production lines over to the war effort.
The 1940s was a very busy time. People had come back from the war, there was fuel rationing, they just wanted to get out and about, so they would catch a bus or a coach to go anywhere. But unfortunately, the industry really wasn't prepared for this sudden growth in trade because they couldn't get new buses in sufficient quantity to supplement the pre-war ones that were left.
It was a case of make, do and mend. Older vehicles were refurbished and in most cases rebodied using the original engine and chassis, but the fleet was aging. At long last, 1946 saw a return to full production for chassis manufacturers, who adopted new techniques such as light alloy construction. Despite the shortage of vehicles, James Smith & Co. became the first company to visit Europe with a sell-out 14-day tour of Switzerland in May 1946. At home, Wallace Arnold offered 14-day tours to Scotland. Run weekly, the charge of £35 was inclusive of lunch and tea, although customers still had to take their ration books. A month later, in June 1946, express coach services resumed when Associated Motorways reopened Cheltenham Coach Station. Things returned to normal when finally, in 1947, coach operators began to take delivery of new vehicles. For Bristol, the first post-war single-deck chassis was the L. Introduced in 1946, the chassis was really just an updated version of the 1937 model.
Yes, it's a 1947 Bristol-built coach, built in Brislington in Bristol. Slightly a bit of a mystery. It was delivered, the chassis of the vehicle was delivered to Salisbury in August 1947. We know that from records, but for some reason it wasn't licensed on the road until May 1949. The reason for that could be they were waiting for somebody to construct the bodywork, or they just stored it up until they needed it. But the body is built in Dartford in Kent, by a firm called John Beadle and Sons. But the Wilson Dorset rebuilt it in 1957 and it was withdrawn in 1962.
This is an early engine. It's actually the earliest known Bristol engine still to exist. It's number 17 of the Bristol engines of this type which were built.
So everybody asks on these vehicles, on the front bulkhead there is a square box with a brass cap on the top of it. It's called an autovac and it works rather like a toilet cistern. It sucks fuel from the main tank into the holding tank and it drops by gravity into the engine. And Bristol were about the last firm to still fit those on vehicles commercially.
As part of the government's nationalisation of the transport industry, the Transport Act of 1947 resulted in the formation of the British Transport Commission. A large part of the coaching industry fell under state control when the Tilling and British Electric Traction Bus Companies passed into public ownership. In 1948, Ribble Motor Services commissioned a double-deck low-bridge coach body with 49 seats on the Leyland Titan PD13 chassis. For use on medium-distance services running to seaside resorts, Ribble's White Lady coaches had luxurious seating. A decade later, Ribble introduced the Gay Hostess super luxury coach service, also on a double-deck chassis.
Most coaches were based on what we call heavyweight chassis, but there were lighter weight coaches, and the market leader here was Bedford. Bedfords became popular in the 1930s. They were smaller coaches, they were lighter, but they were reliable and they could run and run and run. So they were very much the small coach operator's vehicle.
Launched in August 1939 by Bedford, the OB differed from its predecessor as the chassis had been designed for PSV use rather than adapted from a lorry chassis. Production of the post-war design began in 1946. With a modest cost of £495 for the chassis, the OB played a significant part in the growth of the British coach industry, with more than 12,600 chassis built. Duple produced bodies for the OB. The 29-seater Duple Vista Sun Saloon body cost an additional £1,425. 46 other manufacturers, including Plaxton, produced bodies for the OB, but Duple produced the most, more than 4,200. Around 80 OBs are still on the road, with 30 of them operating commercially.
The kind of work that we do with this vehicle nowadays is mainly weddings, proms we do, and perhaps three or four funerals. But the main work is weddings, and we also do car club outings and sometimes family outings from around the area. This coach is peculiar in the fact that, you know, as
today's modern coaches haven't got it, but this has got a sunshine roof in it, which slides back. They let a lot of air in, and in some cases, people at the back didn't like it too much. On a nice hot day, of course, the windscreen opens as well. You can open the windscreen out, which you haven't got that facility on a modern coach, and it actually out, goes right out, so you can have plenty of air coming in at you when you're driving. You get a nice, cool chest and everything, and as long as you keep your app don't blow off, you're all right.
The Bedford OB with Duple body was the most prevalent coach in the 1950s and 60s, if not ever. As Bedford's slogan used to say, you see them everywhere.